So my topic is smart mobility. And then the technical part, which is using optimization and behavioral modeling. In simple terms, what my talk is about making smart mobility really smart. So my research lab is called the ITS, Intelligent Transportation System Lab, and it has two branches. One branch is in Singapore, and the other branch in Cambridge, Massachusetts. And in Singapore, MIT has the only unique off-campus research center that is called the Singapore-MIT Alliance for Research and Technology, and the acronym is SMART. So Singapore has made a major commitment to smart mobility, and so we are doing research at SMART in Singapore on smart mobility. And that's taken from the master plan for smart mobility that was produced by the Land Transport Authority of Singapore. In the US, there is no such centralized plan for smart mobility everywhere, but clearly smart mobility is having an impact. And I selected this cartoon from the New Yorker to demonstrate the impact, or to make a point about the impact that it has had on, or that the ride-hailing companies have had on primarily young people that have no cars. And this shows two young school students. One of them has a smartphone, and the caption says, "Hang on, I'll Uber us a school bus." So it has an impact on the accessibility of young people or carless people, and also the notice that the name of a company is used as a verb, which is usually a sign of success. So in my talk, I want to have four parts. First, research agenda, because I'm talking about the research that we are doing in my research group. Then any kind of research requires experiments. We have a laboratory, we have two laboratories. The first one is to observe real people's behavior. We call it future mobility sensing, or FMS. And the second laboratory is a computer simulation laboratory that we call Simobility. So I will briefly explain what the laboratories that we're using are. And then the main part of my talk will be to talk about smart mobility solutions, and again, how we make smart mobility really smart. And then finally, to talk about the impact that smart mobility, or how we are going to study, how it's going to impact transportation system more broadly. So first, about our research agenda. The technology, the smart mobility technology, is characterized in many different ways, but the key idea is that it is relies on mobile technology, communication, on it's real time, it operates in real time, it's respond to demand, it's personalized, it's shared, and of course it relies on development in vehicle technologies, autonomous driving, electric vehicles, and the like. So that's the technology. And the question is, where is the smart? Where's the intelligent? And so our idea to bring in the intelligence into smart mobility by first collecting information about travelers' behavior, what do they really do? And that's a behavioral data. Then we develop mathematical models and algorithms that describe how people, travelers, react to the services that are offered to them, to the prices, etc., to the conditions on the transportation system. So we develop behavioral model and optimization approaches to design such systems. And then finally, we have a specific ideas on how these systems should operate. And these are the solutions that we are testing. And so to make them more effective, make them more intelligent, As I said, the idea is to use optimization to achieve efficiency. Efficiency in terms of how vehicle fleets are being used, etc. Real personalization requires that we understand what people, how people react to different offerings, and this has to be based on real data. And that's the laboratory that I'll explain, the behavioral laboratory, which is app-based, and the testing using in a system-wide testing of future scenarios, and that's a computer simulation laboratory. So the laboratory, the two laboratory platforms, the first one is the app-based behavioral or behavior laboratory, or FMS. It's a platform that is based on the pervasive availability and use of smartphones, sensing technology that are available, and machine learning algorithms that allow us to, in a non-intrusive way, to observe what people do, what they actually do, and observe it in a high level of resolution so that we know exactly when, what do people do, how far do they walk, how long do they wait for the bus, et cetera, et cetera. And or how long do they search for parking, where do they park, how long do they walk from the parking to their destinations, and so on. So for that, we developed this platform that has three components. The first one on the left is the tracking device. Usually it will be a smartphone, so it's an app for the smartphone, and that relies on the sensing technologies that are available on the smartphone, listed here. The second component is a machine learning backend, which uses the sensor information that comes from the tracking device together with contextual data, things about transportation services, about points of interest, etc., because we are trying to make inference not only on the travel part of people's daily lives, but also about the activities, because if you want to understand transportation or travel behavior, you have to understand why people travel. These are the activities. And so we use contextual data to make inference about people's daily lives. What do they do in terms of where do they stop? What do they do where they stop? When, how do they travel? What modes do they use? Activities and maybe other information. And so that's the idea, is to do it in a non-intrusive way, that a person carrying the device does not have to hear requests from the device to provide information. And but they can. We also developed a friendly user interface such that the subjects can, at their leisure, whenever they have time, consult their data by seeing a timeline, like a diary of what did they do during the day, and then they may wish to edit it or add additional information. So we tested this technology in Singapore, together with the Land Transport Authority. We made a major test, and it was very successful. We also tested it in other places, and this led to significant requests for mostly transportation planning organizations to use the software to conduct travel surveys. And so for that, we have established a startup called Mobile Market Monitor. It is based in the US and in Singapore, and it's already using this technology to conduct surveys in the places listed here, including Tel Aviv, right now as we speak. So that's the behavioral laboratory where we can observe and monitor people's behavior. In addition, as I said, our major laboratory is a computer simulation laboratory where we can test we have a computer laboratory, I will start rushing. And it is designed for a variety of transportation scenario, not just, it's designed to help us evaluate smart mobility solution, but it also can be used for to analyze changes in land use, changes in infrastructure, etc. And this laboratory is actually consists of three different simulators. One that is the top one takes into account how people change location, people and business establishment change their locations and vehicle ownership. The second one predicts how they arrange their daily behavior in terms of activity and travel. And finally, how this is translated to the operations of a transportation system. So each of these simulators, of course, has supply and demand. This is not just one professor working on it. This is a group of professors that have developed it, beginning to use it, have been using it, and further developing it further. So now I'm coming to the main part of my presentation is, okay, how do we use the capabilities that we have to evaluate different smart mobility solutions and make them smarter? And I have four examples, and instead of talking about them now, I'll talk about each one of them at a time. Each one of them is a smart mobility solution. The first one actually is about tolling. And normally tolls are static, but what we are trying to do is make them adaptive so that they can change every 5 minutes or so in response to traffic conditions. And the state of the art, there is a facility like this near Tel Aviv here, in access to Tel Aviv, but the idea is that this is the state of the art, is this is based on rules. What we are trying to do is use behavior, or what we are testing, or what we have tested, is to use behavioral models and being able to predict what the conditions will be so that real optimization can be done in real time to optimize the tolls. So we developed a system that is called Dynamit, and this system takes data in real time from whatever sources of data are available, surveillance data, data from vehicles, and predict what will be traffic conditions and optimize the tolls. And this is particularly useful for situations where there are unusual conditions, traffic incidents and the like. So we are testing these approach on in Singapore and in Texas. In Singapore, it's for area-wide road pricing. There is an existing road pricing in Singapore called electronic road pricing, or ERP. And so we are testing future versions of this system. Right now, it is static. The tolls change by time of day, of course, to manage congestion, but they are static. They remain constant for a while until they change, but it's not adaptive in real time. And so we're testing the adaptive idea in Singapore and in Texas. Again, there is an existing facility, a managed lane similar to what's available operating here in Tel Aviv. And we find that we can achieve significant reduction in travel time and increased revenue. The second solution is autonomous driving. And this idea called AMOD, or Autonomous Mobility on Demand, is an idea that was mentioned here yesterday. There are experiments around the world of essentially autonomous taxi operating in a fairly limited area, which has been well mapped, etc. So that's what we are testing again as well in the simulation laboratory. So it's taxi service, but the idea is to introduce optimization by optimizing the fleet size, establishing service level requirements, and then optimizing the fleet size, and even more important, develop algorithm for rebalancing, where to position the vehicles such that the waiting time can be minimized. And so it's a small area where the autonomous taxi is used primarily as a last mile, first mile, and other local trips, circulation trips. And so in the experiment that we did in a simulation, and soon it also will be done in the field, a sub-area of Singapore is selected, not necessarily the downtown area, could be a residential area, and then circulation in this area for passenger car is restricted, other modes continue to exist, and then we can analyze, we show the impact. So we've shown that we can, for a reasonable size fleet that can be optimized, we can achieve a standard of, say, no more than 5 minutes waiting time. But Of course, we're also interested in ride sharing. There has to be some sharing. Not everybody can go by taxi in that may, for a variety of consideration, we want to encourage also ride sharing. So we developed an algorithm which we call flexible mobility on demand, and the vehicle type is unspecified, could be autonomous, does not have to be. And the idea of this algorithm is that when a request, when a traveler requests a ride, they get a menu. It's a personalized menu designed just for the traveler that requested it based on knowledge of that traveler needs and behavior and preferences. And the traveler receives a menu that in this algorithm includes taxi, shared taxi, and minibus. The difference is the taxi and shared taxi provide door-to-door service, and while minibus, because it has more passengers, cannot provide door-to-door service, so it provides stop-to-stop. So this minibus or this bus service is operates with pre-designated stops in the area or pick-up and drop-off points, but there is no fixed schedule, there are no fixed line, but the schedule and the lines are designed on the fly as demand is arriving or as demand is anticipated. And so that's like an example on how such a menu can be presented. And the behind this, the algorithm, there is an optimization of the fleet, optimization of the utilization, the allocation to different services, and the optimization of the menus that are presented to a given traveler. And so we have done simulation experiments in a suburb of Tokyo and in an area of Singapore. And we worked on it together with Fujitsu Research. And we can design, or we have shown that we can design this menu such that we increase the satisfaction of the users and the utilization of a given fleet of vehicle. And also we have developed methods about how we can, from repeated choices of the travelers, we can learn more about their preferences and optimize better as we learn. Finally, the fourth example is an ongoing project sponsored by the US Department of Energy, an organization called ARPA-E, and where we are designing this tripod. It's a tripod incentive system. So instead of pricing, the idea is to provide incentives. Again, it's not a necessarily new idea. Of course, it's not. But the idea of tripod is that it is, the three legs of our tripod are prediction, optimization, and personalization, so that the incentives are optimized based on our ability to predict what will happen. And given that we can know what will happen, we want to offer incentives that will optimize, say, the conditions or the energy savings, system-wide impacts. And so there are optimization, prediction going on, optimization, and of course, personalization. So the idea is that the respondent, as in the FMOD, the flexible mobility on demand, the traveler that is using the app will get a menu. And the difference is that the menu will have incentives. So the different ways of traveling from an origin to a destination. By the way, notice the tripod can also be pronounced as trip OD. So for a given origin to the destination, the menu specify incentives for different ways of traveling, for different modes, or maybe for different styles of driving, for different routes, etc. So that's what's on the menu. The system, the incentive system, operates with how to allocate these incentives in a way, whatever incentives are available, how to allocate it in the most efficient way to achieve system-wide objectives, in this case, energy savings. And then there is a subsequent optimization on producing a menu that best represent the needs and wishes as a satisfaction, maximize the satisfaction for the user so that they can select an alternative that best matches their preferences. So that's the system. So there are, of course, the users, and what the users do affect what's in the transportation system. What's in the transportation system affect how we do the optimization, and how we do the system optimization affect what incentives are available, which affect the menu, which affect what people are doing, and that's the tripod system. Finally, okay, we can have solutions, we can make them smarter, but then what does it mean in terms of our society, our smart cities, our planet? And for that, we have a new initiative in MIT, that in which we try to answer these questions. How would smart mobility, vehicle and fuel technologies, energy and environmental policies affect future mobility, broadly speaking? So we are using the same laboratories that I described to you, but we want to apply them sort of worldwide. And we classify cities and select prototypical cities, and focusing mostly on mega cities to see how would these scenarios of future development affect more broadly. So this consortium, I forgot to mention on an earlier side, I mentioned our existing sponsors, which are primarily the National Research Foundation of Singapore, the US Department of Energy, the US Department of Transportation, but also private sector companies. So, for example, the work of FMOD was done together with Fujitsu, some other work we are doing together with Ford, and another, the work on toll optimization primarily we are doing with Ferrovial, which is an infrastructure company. But here, this is a consortium of oil companies, car companies, and infrastructure companies that MIT has an energy initiative, as they put together these consortium of companies to study these future scenarios of in these areas, fuels, infrastructures, vehicles, technologies, and the smart mobility modalities of the future. And so that's what we do. I hope I convinced you that in our research, we are book smart by using optimization and behavioral modeling. But by being book smart in this fashion, we hope to be street smart, but in the literal sense of the word, of the phrase. Thank you.